Started. It's a great pleasure to have this meeting here in the Academy of Medical Sciences. The meeting has been oversubscribed, and there are people waiting at the door, I understand. But I think that's a mark of both the topic and the speakers, as we'll see. The Academy, just to mention one brief aim, there are six key objectives, but the main principle is promoting excellence in medical science, and we'll see this evening how excellence in medical science extrapolates to policy and care at a global level. I have some logistic things first of all before I introduce Dame Sally and Professor Whitty. First thing is the proceedings are being filmed and recorded. If, when discussion starts, you have a question or a point you'd like to make, you will be given a microphone by Liz. Liz, can you stand up? And Liz will give you a microphone. You have to give your name and affiliation and then your question or point. There is a hearing loop for those who might need it, and the use of the microphone is crucial because the acoustics are not the best here. Now, my name is George Griffin. I'm the Foreign Secretary of the Academy and a council member. I am a clinical bioscientist and built up the Academic Centre of Infection and led the clinical section of infectious diseases at St. George's, and a little anecdote about that later on. The topic for this evening is as broad or as narrow as we want to make it, and the topic is the importance of scientific input into global health policy. And the areas that we will probably be looking at will be Ebola and the recent epidemic and the response and the future response. We'll also, I'm sure, be looking at antibiotic resistance and how that can be tackled. And then we may go on, if there's time, to talk about near-patient testing and how that might influence chemotherapeutic treatments. Our speakers tonight are both very well known to you. First of all, Dame Sally Davies, of course, is an extraordinary CMO. She pulled together NIHR from nothing, and that was a magnificent achievement, as well as providing independent advice to the UK government on all medical matters. Sally is well known in the UK, and of course she's very well known internationally. WHO and many international committees that she gives advice and help to. In Dame Sally's first annual report in 2013, she focused actually at that stage on infection and the global risks of antimicrobial resistance. And of course, this is one of the things that Sally is now a tireless advocate for. And I hope we'll get into hearing her views on that this evening. Sally was awarded a DBE in 2009 for her services to medicine. And she's Emeritus Professor at Imperial, and she's a Fellow of the Royal Society and of our Academy. So welcome, Sally. Professor Chris Whitty is Professor of Public Health and International Health at London School and a consultant physician. Now, Chris was actually a senior registrar on my unit many years ago, and I could say I learned everything I know from Chris, but I wouldn't be quite as gauche as that. But Chris was clearly going to be a leader when he was working on our unit. Chris has been seconded from 2009 to 2015 to be the Chief Scientific Advisor at the UK Department for International Development, DFID. And we all know the trials and tribulations that have been thrown at Chris with Ebola, with earthquakes, with tsunamis and so on. And Chris has had to deal with those, as well as administering a research budget of £340 million. And the news, of course, you may have seen today that Chris is going to become the Chief Scientific chief scientific officer for research and development in the Department of Health, working alongside of Sally. So congratulations on that appointment, Chris. He will maintain clinical practice and, of course, an appointment at the London School. So what we are going to do this evening, and the agenda is very simple. Chris and Sally are going to give some comments on their view of the scientific scientific advice in guiding them in the global health agenda. Then we will start discussion and have points. The only hard timing we have is that we must finish at 8 o'clock sharp, and between 8 o'clock and 9 o'clock, for those who can and would like to stay in the room that we all met, there'll be a drinks and a nibbles reception. So it's with great pleasure that I introduce Sally and Chris, and please start.
Thank you. So I'm going to start first by saying happy to be filmed, but of course it's never as entertaining when you get the two of us doing a double act on the record than off the record. I've been caught recently when I thought I was off the record, and it's not much fun living through it. The second is to welcome Chris as my partner again, but more so, and to give him his proper title, which will be Chief Scientific Advisor to the Department of Health, and of course he inherits in that my DG role, leading for research and R&D. And I'm absolutely delighted Chris is coming, because I can't cope with the workload. And anyway, NIHR is 10 next year, and it's absolutely great to have someone to give it a bit of a shake and say, does it need some changes? I might find it difficult, but that's a different matter. So the reason we've done quite a lot of double acts is, of course, Ebola. So at the moment, I'm the chief scientific advisor for health. Chris inherits it. He was chief scientific advisor in DFID. And let me use that to explore some of the issues. Speaking for myself, I'm quite a good, or at least I was, hematologist, particularly at sickle cell. And I could do a bit of genomics, but I wasn't very good at lots of other things. So I was delighted when I arrived in the department to, I'll move that higher, to discover that what I needed was there, a series of standing advisory committees where they are run by proper government protocol, so the posts are advertised, interviewed to make sure we get the right people, the agendas and the minutes are published to give us advice. And of course, the particular ones that we called on during Ebola were the Advisory Committee on Dangerous Pathogens. Thank you, George, you were chairing it at the time and all the way through, which was very good. Chris, back in March, called on the Science in Humanitarian Emergencies and Disasters Secretariat, called SHED. So we have a panoply of scientific advisory groups that we can each call on together or separately to be well informed. But if we use Ebola as an example, Chris had started internationally, and he'll tell you about that. But once it was clear it was going to have an implication in the UK, which was in about July, the first thing I did was check that we had advice on, you know, handling it, PPE, all the rest of it from the ACDP, the Advisory Committee on Dangerous Pathogens. We did, and it was being updated. My job was to make sure we had advice from experts, that then that was looked at by Public Health England and the NHS. What could we do with it to formulate policy, to sit over that process to make sure, through challenge and debate, that we'd got something that I felt was scientifically tenable on one side, doable on the other, that I could sell to ministers. You have to remember that as CMO, I'm an independent advisor. As chief scientific advisors, we are there to tell truth to God too. We are also independent advisors. And I set up two ad hoc groups to help me at the beginning. One is a health advisory committee that we set up in an emergency, bringing together a number of people, including Public Health England, looking at the public health and clinical issues in the country. And then we morphed that into a group that I co-chaired with Jeremy Farrer, the Ebola Scientific Assessment and Response Group, looking at vaccines and more specialist issues, because I'm quite good at chairing, but I needed that specialist knowledge, so we were able to advise. Once WHO called an emergency, a public health emergency of international concern, a FEIC, then what had been happening before, which was that officials across government were meeting regularly under central cabinet office coordination, moved up a gear to ministerial and indeed prime ministerial. And that's when the system that's called COBRA is activated. And COBRA actually stands, they're the initials for the cabinet office briefing rooms. That's all it stands for. It's where we go and the processes, we are trained in these processes, to work together as a team. And prime ministerial first time, and then it became ministerial, they're only ministers with a limited number of advisors. In the room with ministers is me as CMO if there is a health impact, the chief scientific advisor to government, Mark Wolpert, if there may be a science impact, and on this occasion with Ebola, we asked for Chris to come because he had a specific expertise and knowledge, and he was so good on the first time, they kept him there for the rest. And the COBRA process starts rolling, and by having a prime ministerial or ministerial one, then Mark Wolpert, as chief scientific advisor for government, stands up a new scientific group called the Scientific Group, the Scientific Advisory Group for Emergencies, SAGE, which we as chief scientific advisors get invited to, but because this was a health emergency and our department was in the lead, I co-chaired with him. And a number of the members of that are here. Peter Piot came, you were invited, didn't come to the first, I think may have come to the second, Jeremy Farrer came. A number of experts you would know came to those meetings invited to help provide advice across government and into COBRA so that we got our response right. We had three subgroups to the SAGE. One I chaired, well no I didn't chair, one I set up on vaccines, I think you came, but I got Professor Deborah Ashby, a medical statistician from Imperial to chair, looking at clinical trials, methodologies, CDC dialed into it from the states, J&J, GSK were there, having debates about methodologies to try and help people design the studies on vaccines. One that Melissa Leach led from Southampton on the social anthropology that turned out to be key. And then a third one of modellers, because we have three groups of modellers, and from SAGE to COBRA, we insist on one agreed model of the disease dynamics, and it brought together Imperial College, Public Health England, and the Department of Health modellers. But plenty of people inputted. I was receiving, and I bet you were too, phone calls from scientists around the country and internationally throughout it. So we had a lot of scientific input to us, but each of us had to advise our politicians and our governments, and then through the our ministers, the more central part. I can tell you now, nothing I recommended was turned down. So if you want to have the debate about so-called screening, I can have it, and I can tell you exactly what we were doing, a complex intervention. And I want to finish before I hand over to Chris on saying I'm very proud of the UK response. Chris led the in-country work from the science perspective. We spent 427 million to date. We've had 1,500 boots on the ground. The military did a wonderful job. DFID did a fantastic job. The NHS volunteers, the Public Health England setting up three labs and their volunteers, a fabulous job. And A, we owe it to those people to do that. We were later than, in retrospect, we should have been. B, from the security perspective, that was the best way of securing our population. I think the Royal Free did a grand job, and Mike Jacobs was phenomenal and looked after our patients very well. So I'm very proud of our response, and it was, to my mind, science-based. We learned a lot. Let me hand over to you, Chris.
Thanks, Sally. I'm going to take a slightly different direction because I think Sally's covered a lot of the stuff on emergencies. Just one riff on that. The first emergency that I got involved with when I joined DFID was the flu pandemic, the so-called Mexican pig flu pandemic. It was a close-run thing, in my view, scientifically, and I think it could easily have gone very seriously wrong with a disconnect between the domestic response and the international response. I learned two things from that. Many things went right. The first of which was there's a real risk of domestic and international pulling in opposite directions. They did for flu, they didn't for Ebola, but that was because we worked at it. It doesn't come naturally, necessarily. Mm. And the second was that the social sciences were thought of as an afterthought far too late in the flu pandemic. And I think one of the things that went reasonably well on the Ebola epidemic, some things didn't go so well, but one thing definitely did, was getting the social sciences much more heavily involved right from the beginning, all the way through the epidemic. And I think that, you know, I cannot stress too strongly how critical that is in virtually every emergency I've come across, as well as other development issues. But I'm going to move on to the other side of the international areas in health, which is thinking more about the development, the long-term development trends. And I'm broadly going to just talk very briefly, and I'm aiming in this because this is a discussion, just to throw out a few ideas which people may wish to pick up and they may not. And I'm conscious of the fact that this is a very mixed audience. So I'm going to start off with some stuff which will be very obvious to some members of the audience, maybe less to others, which is simply to say how well things broadly are going in international health at the moment. I think it's very easy to get depressed until you start looking, for example, at what has been achieved in the things that were highlighted as essential for the Millennium Development Goals. You look at the fantastic reduction in child health, the drop in mortality, almost two-thirds now from malaria, HIV retreating now, maternal health not going down fast enough, but halved over the last 15 years. And I could go through a whole litany of things that have gone incredibly well over the last 15 years. And more importantly, in many ways, the trajectory is accelerating in the right direction. And all of that is based on science. None of those things would have been possible without a very strong scientific foundation, and it would have been very difficult to persuade politicians who are responsible for public money to invest in these areas unless you could say to them with a clear conscience when speaking directly to them, we do genuinely know what to do here. What we need is the money to do it. We need things like Gavi, we need things like the Global Fund, we need things like UNAIDS to spend money, but we actually have a clear scientific basis for what we're doing. So this, as I say, will be obvious to many people, but I think it's very easy to lose these really positive things that have happened. Clearly, there are some things that are going more slowly. Neonatal health, for example, has gone far too slowly compared to many of the other areas. Stillbirths, which came up in the UK last week, domestically, a very serious problem globally. Maternal health, as I say, probably not as much progress as we'd liked, but the forward trajectory has been fantastic. And within that, the UK is not just a user of science for policy, although the UK system for science policy, I will state, I'm happy to be contradicted, I think it's probably the strongest I know, and I'm afraid that's because the rest are very weak. So it's not because I'm saying that the UK is perfect, but what I'm saying is that actually if you look across Europe, you look across many other countries, actually the system simply is not there. So we've probably got the least bad system on offer, and in some areas extremely strong. But also, the UK is incredibly strong as a provider of this science, both in terms of the basic sciences and in terms of the applied sciences. And if you look across the ancient universities, but also things like the London School of Hygiene, where I come from, the Liverpool School, various other places, doing fantastic research that has led not just UK responses, but led policy for the world in many of these diseases. And I could provide, if people wanted, examples in each of the areas you've talked about, where critical bits of the research, both basic and applied, have occurred out of UK institutions. So I think that that is a very strong starting point. I think there are clearly some things that we need to build on. For example, capacity building and transferring skills southward is an ongoing struggle. It's a difficult thing to do. Nevertheless, I think that there's a lot to celebrate. But I just really want, and this is more for the people who are involved in this, I want to then just concentrate on a few challenges I see to this coming up in the next few years. The first one is that in real terms, we have now passed the point of peak spend for donor nations. The ability to make change by spending money for the UK probably peaked about 2 or 3 years ago. And that is basically because the countries we're working in are accelerating in terms of their economies, so the same amount of money buys less. So this means that we're going to have to, if we wish to have the same impact, move much more into smarter things in which research and properly targeted, scientifically targeted interventions, I think, are going to be critical. That is going to be our offer, increasingly, as time goes by, rather than simply being able to write large checks. The second and third, which I think are outcomes of the positive things I talked about earlier, is it's going to get a lot harder in the next 15 years. And the science has got to take account of that reality. So it has been until recently possible to address most of the global health challenges, the serious ones, by mass things, mass distributions of bed nets, mass vaccination campaigns. As poverty fragments into smaller and smaller groups and ill health fragments into those groups, we will no longer be able to rely on those as an efficient way of doing things. And that is going to make life a lot harder, I think, and science has got to find solutions to this which are realistic. Because one of the results of that is the cost effectiveness of many of our interventions is going to go down, the cost per case averted, because it's going to find it harder to find those cases. And we've got to find ways through that. Linked to this, there's not only going to be fragmentation in space, there's also going to be fragmentation in time. And to take an extreme example of this, malaria is likely to move from a situation where it is endemic in Africa. It's the same the whole year, right, it varies by season, but it's year on year, it's basically the same, to a situation where it becomes epidemic over time because of the success we've had. And I think one of the things we learned from Ebola was the world is not in a good place when it comes to responding to major epidemics, wherever they may be. So I think we need to think that really through quite carefully. And finally, in terms of the sort of the victims of our unsuccess, is that increasingly ill health is going to be concentrated in fragile states, which are difficult places to operate and where many researchers have historically not gone. We tended to operate through NGOs, and the link up between academia and NGOs, although it's better than it was 15 years ago, is still far from smooth. And I think that's something we need to work on, because that is going to be the reality. Four other points, and then I think we should open it up to discussion. The first one is that I would divide research into broadly, and this is just for the sake of a discussion, really, three areas. Finding new things, and that this may be the basic science underlying it, or maybe the applied science, but new vaccines, new drugs, new diagnostics. My own view is that we are about at the peak of that being useful. So for the great majority of the major health problems, we are no longer, if we look 15 years out, going to be lacking drugs, diagnostics, or vaccines. There's a huge push going on at the moment, and rightly, but I think that is probably going to be a time-limited one. We will, of course, have to, and Sally was incredibly self-restrained in not mentioning this, deal with the fact we will lose drugs to drug resistance, and we'll lose vaccines to diseases evolving around them. Nevertheless, the wish list of things we really need, the macro filaria size, the drugs for Vivax malaria, hypnozoites, and various other practical things are going to get shorter and shorter. And because people's incomes is going up, the need to drive down prices per unit is going to be increasingly not the major challenge for development. But the trouble is, this is the thing which is most easy to sell politically. Saying, Minister, I can get a new vaccine for X is a very easy sell. The second thing we need to do is to understand the environment in which we operate so we work more efficiently. And here I'd just like to flag a risk. And the risk is mass data. It is extremely easy now to pull together large amounts of very bad data with very narrow confidence intervals and publish them in The Lancet and say, we've solved your problems, guys. We know what you need to do. Actually, a lot of the data that is presented in that way is based on almost no field data. The real confidence intervals are massive, and I think we're kidding ourselves that we know what's going on, we don't. we've got to rely on field data, not just on the ability to pull stuff off Google and mash together large amounts of very weak data. And I think that is a real risk, because it's extremely tempting. It's cheap and it looks very powerful, because the numbers look very big. The third thing is that this is an area where the UK has historically had a great tradition, is that for most of the diseases, most of the serious health problems we can see now, the problem is not that we don't have the tools, and it's not that we don't know where the disease is that we're not delivering efficiently. There should be nobody dying of malaria pretty well in Africa in this year. We know how to diagnose it, we know where people have it, the drugs are available, and they work. And they're relatively cost-effective, well, they're very cost-effective and relatively cheap, and yet they don't get it. Still, although things have gone right down, 450,000 children a year are dying of malaria. So these issues about how to deliver stuff to the right people is going to require a huge scientific effort, but is a very different kind of science to the kind of science that develops you a new drug or a new vaccine. And this is something where the UK has taken a great lead, but I think we're going to have to go further if we seriously want to tackle these major problems. And finally, I just want to comment on one issue of politics. I think we are enormously fortunate in the UK that almost uniquely in the northern world, there has been a political consensus between all the major parties that international development is important and that health is important within that. I think that consensus is going to be more difficult to maintain as we move, and I can explain in more detail if you're interested, from infectious diseases being the primary problem to non-communicable diseases being the primary problem. I think people look, the general public, look at things like malaria, they look at infectious diseases, and they say infectious diseases is a thing of the past in this country. We should not allow these countries to have to face these problems. We should try and sort them out. Whereas when they look at things like obesity, like diabetes and so on, they say this is a problem for all of us. Should we really be investing our efforts internationally, when actually this is a problem for us domestically? And I think this political reality is something we're going to have to address. And I think all the politicians I've dealt with have found it easier when you're talking about neglected tropical diseases or malaria than when you're starting to talk about stroke or obesity. That point I think we'll stop, because I think the main point of this is to have a proper discussion.
Sally and Chris, thank you very much. That's a great start. Just one or two comments I perhaps could make before we open discussion. First, the joined upness of science. Sally, I think we are real leaders in this. And my experience of chairing the Advisory Committee of Dangerous Pathogens for 9 years, and Chris has just taken this on now, was this was one of the only tripartite government committees, Department of Health, DEFRA, and HSE. Public Health England were on that committee, and it was very, very easy at these meetings to get information at a very high scientific level and know exactly who to pass that on to. And I'm sure, Chris, that will continue in the future. It's one of the few committees that actually was maintained and, in fact, extended when the last administration took over. It's great to know that we are in the forefront, but we can't rest on our laurels. That's very, very clear. But the spending review could have been a lot worse for academe and for global health. And I hope we get perhaps to talk about the new Ross initiative later on between Gates and I think it's the Department of Health. And Sally, I'm sure you perhaps it's not finalised yet, but it was very exciting to hear in the spending review that could have all been completely different to hear about this. So I think we're ready to start discussion and questions now. If you have a question, would you put your hand up and Liz will bring the microphone. Right, Liz, right next to you. Can you stand up? Can you give your name and affiliation, please?
Hi there. So I'm Jack. I'm from Brighton and Sussex Medical School. At the end of your talk, it was discussed a bit about public perception of infectious diseases versus non-communicable diseases. And I was just wondering if you think there can be or there need to be any changes about the way the media reports public health issues or national health issues, and if there should be any movement or change in that area.
Okay, so the question is the media and how it approaches public health? And we all know what happens in the Daily Mail and other reputable newspapers. I have to say that, of course. Sally, would you like to start on that one?
I think a lot of the media are really good, but I find it worrying, and I'm on record as saying this, that we have normalised overweight and obesity. But when they write about overweight and obesity, they show gross people, not the slightly large or somewhat large, so that they're then stigmatising these people as well, so that we're normalising it but stigmatising the very overweight, and they need help, you know, they need medical care, maybe some psychological support. So that seems to me to be wrong. So I think the problem is that they report science pretty well, they report public health fairly well, but you have to always give them an angle that will give them a story. So they're always wanting it to be the cure for cancer, or it's awful, or whatever. And it's very difficult to have a steady debate about science and how it's usually incremental and actually flip-flops a bit, you know, and particularly on things like DART. I still think my mum was right, a little of everything and the moderation in all things, you know, is probably the healthiest. But they like coming out with a view, and we have to, from the public health perspective, hold that and try and work with it. But in general, I think we're lucky with our media here, and I have to just highlight that Fiona Fox and the Science Media Centre do a fabulous job in doing science briefings, in providing experts to talk to and about all the science stories. So I know that whatever's out there, there will be some stuff from the Science Media Centre that will put it right. But of course, seeing Heidi in the second row, we always have problems with the media on vaccines. Look at the problem in Japan, particularly at the moment with HPV and is it called POTS syndrome, that's beginning just to come over here, and people saying that, you know, it's unsafe. And how do you counter that? It's a very long-term business.
I think on the international side, I think on the whole, the media has, it's always your best friend and your worst enemy. But I think overall, the UK media has been extremely responsible on most of its reporting of most stories. We can all think of extreme exceptions and the kind of blaring headlines. Some of them, I have to say, started off, and I'm aware of the fact we got a sometime editor of the BMJ in the front row, so I'm going to... Some of them actually started off in the medical press, and then got picked up at the main press. So we shouldn't just blame the Daily Mail. I think we can also look to some of our distinguished white and blue journals for some of the things which actually can lead to difficult stories. I think where I worry is not so much actually when a thing gets pulled into hysterical headlines. That kind of happens. It's when journals which are read as extremely authoritative oversimplify a problem and therefore make it more difficult to explain how you need to see your way through. For example, 3 weeks ago, The Economist had a front page and a lead editorial that implied, if you read it quickly, that actually all we needed to do was eradicate 12 diseases and the world would become a really happy place. Well, you know, life's a bit more complicated than that, and there are a number of things that they hadn't fully, I think, worked through. And so I think what we need to do is stay engaged with all bits of the media, but that includes not assuming that just because it's a very authoritative thing like the FT or The Economist, they'll always get it right, and keep a running dialogue with them, because generally they want to be accurate.
Sally, the theme of our meeting is science advice and global health. Do you think, I mean, in the committees that you deal with and then pass on evidential information with science to ministers, you have a sensible response, even though they don't know a lot about the field. Can you use science and evidence base of science with the press, or do they ignore that?
Well, that's what I do through my annual reports. As you know, I bring experts together who write different chapters, and I write the overarching, what does this mean for the nation and for policy? And it works very well, and the ministers actually, the relevant ministers usually read them. I'm always surprised when they say, oh, I like that chapter or whatever. So I think you can do it, But it's a steady building of the understanding. Ministers are very variable. We have a public health minister at the moment, Jane Ellison, who is superb, and through Ebola, she read stuff from CDC, she read all sorts of stuff, and was quite challenging. I read this, why are you saying that when I saw this, you know? And that was really good, because she was very interested. But they have come with different levels of scientific expertise, so we just have to work at it.
Yeah.
And some are not interested.
Okay, Kevin.
Thanks very much. Kevin Marsh, I've got a dual affiliation, so Oxford and also the African Academy of Sciences. Chris, I was interested in your sort of idea that as we move from through the epidemiological transition, it'll become harder to, from the advocacy point of view, to persuade people to spend. But do you think that's necessarily a bad thing? I mean, I think you could make an argument. I find that a lot of people completely overestimate the amount of overseas development money that goes in general, but underestimate the amount that goes for health. And some of it that goes for health, I think, has been positively dangerous in terms of the way it's deviated health systems in countries. You know, HIV is the classic, but it's not the only one. And I wonder if sort of a move away from funding specific disease-orientated things wouldn't be actually a good opportunity to rebalance the whole way we spend in that way, so long as it remains a commitment to an overall level of funding. So I didn't see it quite as negative. I also think there's no danger of the demand running out. I mean, it's wonderful that the Ross is going to put $1 billion in, but as you know, we're short in malaria alone of $3 billion a year, and we will be for the next 20 years. So I don't think there'll be a drop in demand for infectious disease, but I'm not sure that it's really a bad thing if it becomes harder to advocate for specific diseases as we move to non-communicable diseases.
So, Kevin, are you thinking of syndromic attacks or rather than specific
disease
attacks?
I'm really thinking that it is easy to sell, you know, Gavi, but Gavi's going to need a lot of money forever. It's easy to sell malaria, but as I say, malaria is going to have a massive underfunding for a long time. I think it will be hard to sell stroke and hypertension, but I think, you know, actually with many of the parts of the world we're talking about having rapid economic development, I think a shift so that funding is not necessarily towards health per se is not necessarily a bad thing.
Okay, and Gavi wouldn't have worked.
But I'm interested in Chris's view because he has to deal with it or has had to deal with it.
Gavi wouldn't have worked to the extent it did if Gates hadn't given money for the routine vaccination.
No, absolutely. But I think Chris is right, though, that it's an easy sell, relatively infectious disease, and I think it will be a hard sell for adult non-communicable diseases, but I'm not sure it'd be so disastrous.
Well, I will half answer that, Kevin, but I'm only half answering because I think you've given two points which strike me as contradictory, which is, wouldn't it be a good thing if there was less money and either there was going to be a gap in terms of funding on malaria and various other things?
Yeah.
Now, where I think that the UK has actually been quite sensible is the way that money is spent. It has tried to push money towards health systems in general, but in explaining it to the public, the stories have tended to be in relatively stovepiped ways, which talk about malaria and so on, because that's a much easier communication. Talking about health systems is very, very difficult to explain to anybody. So you need to give a story that explains things linearly. You're not going to solve malaria unless you solve the health systems of Africa. You can do some things vertically with bed nets, but there are a whole lot of stuff you can't do, to take the example you gave. The problem I think we have is the science of, you know, I was challenged by my ministers regularly when they say, I've heard all this about health systems, tell me what a health system strengthening is. And the answer is the evidence for this is actually remarkably weak. So we, the scientific community, have got I think the primary job is for us to end up with a serious package of things that says this is what strengthening a health system actually leading through to health improvements genuinely looks like with a proper evidence base, rather than just pushing money into health systems in the round, which we know is inefficient, and a lot of it is probably not achieving what we're doing. We've not done enough of that. So I think the blame for that, frankly, lies in the academic community, of which I'm part, because I think all of us have not taken that as seriously in terms of being really rigorous about it as we should have been. And I'm afraid that universities, which tend to be even more stovepipe than development agencies, don't make that easy. Trying to get proper health systems research done in Oxford is not easy. And I think this is a problem that we've got to solve, not just internationally, but also domestically, because the key to a lot of the multiple morbidities that we're going to deal with, whether people have multiple morbidities because they're poor or multiple morbidities because they're old, comes in trying to get this problem scientifically solved.
I agree. The international lecture this year in the Academy was by Vikram Patel, who talked about multiple morbidity and how India was attacking that with, of course, few doctors and transferring the care for multiple morbidity into the community. I remember Peter Piot gave a lecture at St. George's, must have been 8 or 9 years ago, on multiple morbidity and non-communicable disease being a thing of the future. I wrote back to him and said, Peter, thank you very much, that was a great lecture, but most of the people die of infection in the end. Exclamation mark. I mean, you know, and diabetes, for example, septicemia and gangrene are major infection type problems. Paul Cosford.
Thank you, Paul Cosford, Medical Director, Public Health England. I've got two very brief questions, if I may. One, Chris, you mentioned the infectious disease versus non-communicable diseases, but I wonder whether you think we give enough emphasis on chemical, radiation, environmental hazards, the science of climate change and its impact on developing countries and so on, if you could comment on that.
Let's do one question at a time, Paul, then we won't forget. You keep the microphone for the second one, Chris. Radiation.
No, you do that.
Radiation and chemicals.
I wouldn't put radiation high on international development problems at this moment in time. Clearly, environmental issues are critical, and it depends where you are, how critical they are. If you're in an area, for example, of Bangladesh, where there's a lot of arsenic poisoning, clearly it's going to be a very different issue than if you're, you know, that's bigger problem than, let's say, malaria in some areas. I think, though, that we have to be careful that we don't get faddish. So, for example, some of the stuff that is labelled as climate change in health is real, and there really is a linkage, and it's justifiable scientifically. Some of it is because medical scientists want to get in on the act, and they feel as global citizens they wish to be involved in this. And that's not good science. It may be good advocacy, but it's not good science. So I think we need to stick with the science. And if there is genuinely a climate change component, great. Much more importantly, though, is generally going to be environmental ones, as you say. And environment is absolutely critical for all of these diseases. I mean, you know, the old-fashioned notation of diseases, you know, water-washed, water-borne, water-associated, and so on, still remains true. What environment you live in defines what diseases you're going to get, and dealing with that environment is critical.
Paul, second one?
My second question was just thinking, Sally, about the importance that government sets on public reassurance and how that sometimes alters the way you give scientific advice as to what might need to be implemented in order to maintain that public reassurance. Whether you wanted to comment on that.
I think that's a caddish question from you.
Sorry.
If I may say so. So what he's talking about is screening for Ebola. And quarantine, but we managed to avoid quarantine. So the question is, how do you take science and get it right for ministers and the public? And it was clear from the modelling, supported by all of us, that the risk of a case of Ebola coming into this country was low, particularly once the flights stopped. And, of course, they did exit screening, so it was unlikely we would get anyone who left West Africa without a pyrexia and developed it on the journey that could happen. So was it worth screening at the airport? And I, following a lot of debate with scientists and everyone, supported what we did, which was a complex intervention. So it was screening a bit like luggage screening, finding those who had not guns but had come from West Africa. Then they were taken off to see first of all, put them on a register if they were returning healthcare workers or risk journalists. And our register was the most effective in the world and is the fullest in the world and everything. And that protected them and everyone else. Were they from West Africa and might have come in contact with it, in which case they needed to know under public health regulations that they could have free health care, they'd get the best outcomes, and they wouldn't infect others, and this is how to monitor themselves, and here's a phone number to ring. And so it was a complex intervention because it was to pick up those with pyrexia, pick up those who were returning healthcare workers, pick up those who needed to know they could have free health care, if they got it and what to look for. And then there was a final part to it, which was public reassurance. and I'm quite clear about that. There was an important role where, unlike in the States where there was panic, we had public reassurance, this is what we're doing to protect you. And I think that that is a valid thing to do. We did debate quarantine, you know, of both healthcare workers who didn't have it and people who might have it. And the answer is, if you might have it, you have to be isolated to protect everyone, and that's not quarantine. And quarantine, when you'd been a high risk, well, you'd been looking after patients, but you were asymptomatic, was just not worth doing, and we persuaded them out of it. And I think it was a fair debate. You were party to it. The ministers were robust, and science won the day.
And public awareness was greatly raised, of course. I think that was a huge effort. Mm. And it was expensive, of course, Sally. I mean, there was extra money to do.
It was, but that was probably the... Well, I mean, I haven't seen the bill, but I think it was the price worth paying to make sure we protected everyone, both our returning healthcare workers and everyone else, and got that public reassurance. We didn't have to worry.
Yeah. Absolutely right. John next, and then Richard.
Thanks, George. So, John Cohen, also Brighton and Sussex Medical School and the International Society for Infectious Diseases.
Not a student, I should
Not
say.
A student anymore, sadly. Always a student, George, but not technically. Chris, you gave the example of malaria as an example of the problem of access, making the point that actually there's quite a lot of stuff that we can already do, and indeed in the next 10 or 15 years or so, the problem is delivering it, is access to care. And you said that actually we needed more science to underline how we get around the problem of access. But I guess I would have thought that much of it is just about political will, not about science. So could you say a bit more about how you think science will help us to improve access beyond simply, as it were, discovering new drugs? Okay.
Hmm. Yeah, well, you can.
So just take malaria, and let's just take malaria treatment rather than prevention, although there are completely separate issues of prevention. If you look at Africa as a whole, there's a group of people who get antimalarials, and there's a group of people who have malaria, and they're not the same people. So a lot of antimalarials are given, in many areas, maybe 90% of the antimalarials are given to people who don't have malaria at all. Now, that isn't because we don't have diagnostic tests. These days, George mentioned this in the introduction, we have very effective rapid diagnostic tests. But if you do trials of rapid diagnostic tests, what you find is the doctors or the other prescribers like the tests, they use the tests. If there's a positive, they give an antimalarial. And if there's a negative, there's a 50% chance they'll still give an antimalarial. Now, that is a scientific challenge. And solving that, and just using that as an illustration, those kind of things working out, and that's a combined epidemiological and social science challenge that needs to be sorted out if you want to deal with the management of febrile illness, which is the commonest cause of presentation to outpatients anywhere in Africa. So that's the kind of area where we do have the science needs to sort this out, because it's actually more cost-effective to treat the malaria properly the first time. This isn't because people don't have the tools, or that they can't afford the methodology, they're just doing it wrong. And science can help us to help them do it right.
So I would add to that, how is it that Coca-Cola can get to the most remote parts of the world, but the drugs that are needed can't? And it's called logistics, and logistics is underpinned by a whole set of science, queuing theory, operational modelling, all sorts of things like that. We don't do much work in that sort of way to look at how to deliver programs. So not only the anthropological issues you raise, but political and societal issues. So I think there's a massive science underpinning that we don't yet have.
Anybody who's been in Africa and talked to an African minister will be under no illusions. Political will to deal with malaria is very, very high on their list of priorities. I don't think that's the missing ingredient in this case. It may be for some other health problems, but not for that one.
Richard.
I'm Richard Smith, and I have many hats, but the most relevant one here is that I'm the chair of the board of ICDDRB, which I know Chris knows what that is, but probably most of the rest of you don't. It's the International Centre for Diarrheal Disease Research in Bangladesh. And I have a question for each of you, if that's all right. I'll do it one at a time.
Thank you.
Sally, I wonder what happens once there's a sense that the Ebola pandemic is over. What is the role of science and policy then to try and avoid this happening again?
First of all, you have to mop up in country. So it's only just becoming, in West Africa, safe. I think we have to continue to work with the vaccines we've got, make sure that we can get them licensed, and potentially we will need to roll them out in some of those communities, at least for the healthcare workers and the burial workers, because we now know that with survivorship there are continued ongoing risks. And I think what I'm seeing is a literature which says actually Ebola probably pops up more than we realized. It was just handled by communities, rural communities, so we didn't see that much of it. So there's more work on vaccines. It has stimulated a whole pile of debate about World Health Organization and global governance reform, and a lot of discussion about how do we prepare for other epidemics, neglected diseases, or other emergent diseases. Are we ready for them? And what other vaccines need developing. So part of the Ross Fund is actually, I was just looking, 120 million for vaccines development, including 20 million for our UK vaccines network that Chris chairs, bringing everyone together to discuss what needs doing, what can the UK contribution be.
And a question for you, Chris. You alluded briefly to the problem of building capacity in low and middle income countries. And I see Peter sitting there who talks about global health 4.0, which is when it's led from low and middle income countries. I wonder, can you say a bit more about that?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of people. I mean, I'm looking at Kevin Marsh, Peter, many other people in the audience who are really experts in this, insofar as there are experts. And I think that my comment on this would be, we all agree that you need to build capacity in the developing South, and there's plenty of incredibly bright and enthusiastic people who are really keen to do it and would do it well. There is no really good model where you can say this is the way, this has really worked and this is how you crack it, because you've simultaneously got to develop individuals, institutions, the overall research architecture. One bit on its own, a brilliant African or Asian scientist in a dysfunctional university, or a well-run university finance department with without a good primary and secondary education system that's feeding through, or whatever it may be, all the bits need to tie together. That's difficult. And it's particularly difficult, I have to say, for bilateral donors, because bilateral donors are subject to the political cycle. To do serious capacity building, you're really having to think from the time someone enters school through to the time they become a serious scientist. That's a very, very long period. So things which are going to go in five-year cycles, the chance you're going to be able to maintain it for a long time is very difficult. And we need to think through that mechanistic question. This is no one's fault. That's just a mechanistic question. But we also, the science of how you do it is very, very badly worked through. So lots of people will bang the table and say, my way is the best way to develop capacity, and that's because there is no evidence, and therefore they can afford to have their wild prejudices. You know, we don't really know how to do this well, and we should be honest with ourselves about that, whilst we all accept it's important.
Sally, could I just ask about rapid response, just following on from Richard? One of the things in the spending review that was interesting was this fund for Public Health England to have rapid response within 48 hours. To a new epidemic area or whatever. Is that from the Ross Fund, or is it just a separate DH,
well,
or is it not worked out yet?
A number of initiatives have been, the government term is brigaded under the Ross Fund. The Fleming Fund comes under the Ross Fund too. What we have done, and we've had the first meetings and advertised, and people have filling in the forms, is invited academic partners to say how they would contribute to a rapid response fund, just as Public Health England itself is saying what would it contribute. We envisage a smallish team, which is part academic, part Public Health England, with a cross-honorary contracts, shared leadership, well, single leadership and accountability into government, where when they're not responding to something that we're worrying about at the request of WHO or government, they are actually over 50%, I've forgotten how much time, but over 50% of the time in low-income countries, acclimatized, contributing to research work or audits or something there, but that we are able, because we see a signal and we're worried, humanitarian, an earthquake, infection, to send them at 48 hours notice to do a diagnostic and start a response, start to help on the public health side. Mm. We're also developing through UK Med a reservist force of public health people. So at the moment, under UK Med, we had orthopaedics and trauma people. Because of Ebola, we developed infection people, and now we're going to develop a public health reservist force so that if it builds up, there are people with special training who we know have volunteered previously, been screened, and are ready to deploy if needed.
Brilliant. And I know for years you've been an advocate of academe, Department of Health and Government links at a very working level, and this strikes me as one that is
going to be
perfect.
A classic NIHR style.
Yep.
You won't know which bit is which.
Yeah. And R, of course, is something Jeremy Farrow has been very keen on in this situation and how difficult it was to do, given what happened. But had there been preparation along the lines you're talking, it perhaps would have been a bit easier.
The preparation might be in different countries, so you can't say that. I think Jeremy and I usually agree, but his idea you can do randomised controlled trials in the middle of a pandemic remains my gold standard, but reality is
you
it's awfully
it.
Difficult.
Yep. Good. Peter.
Peter Piot from the London School of Hygiene Tropical Medicine. First of all, thank you both for your leadership, because keeping the scientific standards high in the midst of epidemics and other development issues is not easy, I know from experience. Now, when we talk about scientific advice and development at the global level, the elephant in the room is the WHO, the World Health Organization. And last week, I was part of a panel that presented some analysis of WHO's performance in the Ebola crisis, and it was not great, to say the least. And it was a déjà vu also. If UN AIDS exists, it was because of failure of WHO to respond to AIDS. And so what we need, and we need a WHO, there's no doubt about it. So the question is really, to both of you, do you see both the internal and external willingness for reform that's needed? Is there a coalition of member states, because it's not just the secretariat of member states, that could lead to a more performing, better performing WHO? And not only for epidemics, because that's probably an easier part than the rest. And what are the core functions of WHO? It was probably the only report saying, calling for a major increase in contributions and budget of WHO. Personally, I think it could be decreased the budget, as long as WHO concentrates on what WHO can do.
If I got that right, Peter, you're saying we need a coordinating group of some sort, but there must be real expert rapid response, which may not be that coordinating group.
I wasn't even thinking of coordination in this.
Uh-huh.
Just to see WHO is not fit for purpose anymore for the world today, and how can it become better? And it's a more general...
Okay.
I mean, we
That's
can go into
summary.
Details, but...
Sally, and then Chris.
Can devote another session of
or
the
you'll
Academy.
Do it the other way.
It was inevitable that you would ask this question, Peter. And, of course, your analysis in that Lancet paper was right. The question is, how do we put it right? And I think that the present DG has embarked upon reform. She set up an expert group to advise, led by Barbara Stocking. She's accepted all that advice. She's already appointed a deputy DG for emergencies. She's looking at the governance for how it can have some independence and everything, and I think she's started reform well. This is a lonely position for her. We are being challenging and supporting because we believe that you, as you do, we need a WHO. We need member states to come together under the UN for global health. There are others who think we should get rid of WHO and then recreate it. Hey, you know, that's not going to happen. So we have to try and reform. I think she will go on doing a good job for another year, reforming. What worries me is that, as many of you know,
Margaret
Chan, the Director General, is that the election will come in 2017 for the new Director General. Some people are already declaring that they would like to be the next Director General. So she will lose her mandate 6 months before the end, which may slow it then, though we'll try very hard to support her so she will go on delivering to the end. Meanwhile, will we be able to get a Director General who is a true leader, who can stalk the corridors of power, tell truth to power, can take on heads of government and say, you may want this, but that's not in the world's interest. Can we get someone of the caliber we need? And I worry about that because I don't think health produces many global leaders of that sort, and everyone expects it to be a health practitioner. And actually, maybe we need someone who's health literate but not a health graduate in order to get there. So my worries are not for the next year. I think we're on a good path. They come in a year's time, 18 months' time. Will we get a successor that we can support and trust in this leadership role?
Mm. But given the time it takes, Sally, I mean, we've got to be thinking about that now.
Well, clearly we are, as people are declaring, but I'm not going to declare my hand as a voting member of the executive board.
Absolutely. Yeah.
My view is entirely a personal one, so don't take this as representing DFID, DH, anyone, apart from me. WHO was set up with two major millstones around its neck, which have got bigger, and there's a new one. The first one is it's set up with the structure of regional WHOs as well as a central WHO, each with their own electoral mandate. And it was done just to keep PAHO on board. Historically, that isn't the reason now. But no one would set up a system that had a whole series of different groups of different electoral mandates doing different things, fighting over the budgets. It's just mad. Mm. That's not WHO's fault. The second thing is that, and now unraveling that's going to be difficult. The second thing is that the funding for WHO, member states, not the UK, have continually tried to stop increasing the central contribution, which gives WHO flexibility, and have given project funding, and that makes it very difficult to do these kind of things seriously. No private sector organisation, no public sector organisation would set itself up with that kind of budget system. It just doesn't make any kind of sense. And then you've got the problem that all multilaterals have, which is that the bigger and more important and more technically proficient all the countries of the world become, an incredibly good thing, the more different voices there are around the table, the less easy it is to get consensus, and WHO is a consensus-based organisation, for better or for worse. If you put those together, you've got a very, very difficult aim, and I thought that the Lancet paper was excellent, but it's having to patch around these really quite fundamental central flaws. And unless there is will to change those, I think it's going to be very difficult for WHO to be the WHO that all of us and WHO want it to be. But to be clear, WHO does some things really well. I think I'm not one of those who takes a kick at WHO every time they're mentioned. And we must take very much the view that WHO is ours rather than it's they. And why do they mess up? You know, they are part of all of us. And so I think we have to do our best to try and work around these. And if we can fix them, and I think there is more of a consensus from some people to fix at least some bits of this, along with the, in terms of the balance between the centre and the regions, for example. But it's a slow process because there are a lot of people with feet on the brake. and relatively few people with feet on the accelerators on this.
Peter, you, WHO and HIV at the beginning, if I remember correctly, but do correct me, Jonathan Mann set up a unit for HIV within WHO, which did not report at that time to the Director General. It was seen as something special and different. And then, of course, he was killed, poor chap, in the Do you remember what happened there? I know there was something special about the governance of that response.
Is the right person to ask?
Yes.
Well, actually, he did. Jonathan Mann did report directly to the Director General, and one of the big points of friction was exactly the first point at Christmas, because the Global Programme on AIDS was working directly with countries, and the regional offices could not tolerate that. And so and when Nakajima became Director General, he brought it back to normal. And that was the origin of a major conflict, besides differences in strategy. And there was a board of donors and so on, but that's not unusual. Several programs have that. But that is then another start of the balkanization of an organization. Like in UNAIDS, I never accepted earmarked contributions. It was all voluntary, but you can, you know, but it was to support the agreed plan and the agreed strategy. And I think that's what's happening now at WHO, is that decrease of donor confidence, so donors earmark more and more their contributions. Hence, the organization is not capable of doing its core function. Mm. And then the confidence goes further down. So once one need to break through that kind of breach of trust, I think. And my worry is, when I see what happened at the World Health Assembly, that many countries, there is no willing and no interest in reform. And there is a big schism between, let's say, G7 type of countries and then low, middle-income countries who don't want that. So it is a very, very difficult job. I fully accept that. Sorry.
On to you, please. Well, let's hope the lesson has been learned from that, Peter, that schism at the beginning with HIV.
Alessandra Legare from the Royal Society of Biology. So one of the things that was remarked by Chris was that actually the global public health situation is not that bad and has improved a lot in recent years. And the focus tonight is scientific advice, but actually many of the things we have discussed have to do with institutions, logistics, research beyond the medical sciences. So my question is, how much of that improvement in global public health can be attributed to actual advances in medical science and natural sciences? How much can be attributed to all the other factors we have discussed? Thank you.
Thank you. Chris, I think that's your best place to answer this.
Go on, you're the public health doctor, not me.
I think anybody who tries attribution between the basics and the basic sciences, the applied sciences, and the political and social environment, even for one disease, is going to end up looking very stupid, okay. Because there is no good way to do this. But what you can say for sure is that each one of those has been necessary but not sufficient. So, you know, all of the drugs we've talked about, all the diagnostics, all the bed nets, all of these things have started off as basic science and have moved through a series of things to applied and then to operationalization. My point, and I wanted to be clear, that I think there are still very, very major challenges out there. I was simply saying the trajectory is heading in the right direction. If we want to get on top of those problems, we are also going to have to rely on outstanding science. But my sense is that for the kinds of problems for the developing world, it's actually, we're moving increasingly into an area where the proportion of effort is going to have to go higher for the operationalization compared to the basic science. Not because basic science isn't important per se, absolutely not, but because it's actually our problem, our rate-limiting step is not lack of the kinds of things that basic science produces. It's lack of delivery of the things that we know work. There are some very glaring exceptions to that, but in broad terms, that would be my view overall. But there are very many areas where basic science is what we need. So, you know, if we wanted an HIV vaccine, for example, we're right at basic science. If we wanted a whole variety of other drugs which are not there, we're right at basic science, and we shouldn't forget that. It's just that there are many areas where basic science is not the primary problem.
Yeah. We'll be coming on to antibiotic resistance in a moment. Point at the back and then Colin.
I just had two quick questions. I'm Tracy Eastman, and I work for the partnership between the British Medical Journal and the University of Cape Town. And we work on programs designed to strengthen primary care systems in LMIC environments. So this is a program that's been developed in South Africa and is now being piloted in other low- and middle-income countries.
One question at a time.
The question is, firstly, focusing on SDGs, how can we combine, take our combined strengths and knowledge in order to fast-track support to LMICs to achieve SDG goals? And secondly, in terms of funding for implementation, there seems to be a dire need for more funding to be directed into implementation rather than research programs.
Okay. Chris, implementation rather than research.
Well, I mean, I think that if you look at the SDGs, and for those of you who have read them, you'll know what I'm talking about. For those who haven't read them, because they're interesting. But if you look at the SDGs in health, which are much less focused than the MDGs in health were that preceded them, they range from ones where, in a sense, the science is established and it's a matter of delivery, through to ones where actually we just don't know what to do and there's a really serious scientific effort that will be needed before we get anywhere near implementation. I'm not going to go through them one by one saying where I think they are, but if you read them, you'll make your own judgments. But I don't think there's a single one of them that can be achieved with no more science. And all the ones that can be achieved are going to be mining the back catalogue of science that has made it possible to get to where we are at the moment, accepting that we could actually go a lot further. The problem for many of these diseases is not primarily one of resource, although there may be misallocation of resource, but it's not that the total pot of resource is inappropriate, but often we don't quite know what to do to be most cost-effective or most effective in our interventions.
After this question.
Okay, I'll be fast. My name's Abby. I'm a medical student, and I'm also part of MedSci UK, which is the student global health network in the UK. So you have mentioned the anti-malarial prescribing problem, and it is indeed a scientific problem, as you said. But it is it not also a deeply rooted cultural problem? So what can we do if science can't solve the global health problem and the underlying cause is cultural? For example, malaria, it's great that it is a top priority, and there is political will to change it. However, what about HIV infection in LGBT individuals? So there is scientific evidence to show that that population is more significantly affected by HIV, however it's illegal. So what can you, as scientific advisors, do to influence policy in such culturally sensitive circumstances? Thank you.
I'll start, but I think this segues neatly into what the antimicrobial resistance story
is. Does it?
Yes. So, have a go, Elisa. Firstly, I love MedSci. I think it's fantastic. And it's great to see people who are committed to international health right from the beginning of their careers, and all I hope is they will maintain that for the rest of their careers. Secondly on that, if you want to change behaviour, you broadly have two ways of doing it. One way is to try and change everyone who's currently practicing or currently living or currently, you know, doing their normal thing. And the second way is generational. Now, if you take attitudes, to take your example, to lesbian and gay people in the UK, the shift is generational. You can predict what people's attitudes will be largely by their age. And a generation just has to grow old and die before a particular view dies out. The same was probably true of witchcraft in its day. So I think that, you know, starting with medical students is absolutely critical, because there you're dealing with a generation. You can do both. You can change both overall behaviour and you can change a whole generation. And if you look at, to take the example of the malaria anti-malarial prescribing, medical students are much better at changing their minds quickly that you need a new method of doing things than their elders and supposed betters. As anyone who's been through medical school knows, people, once they reach my stage, are extremely set in their ways. There's nothing more conservative than the medical profession. And the art of changing the minds of doctors once made up is a difficult one and has to rely on good social science. And not necessarily social scientists, anthropologists, people who are good at marketing, a whole variety of sciences you tend to see in the private sector. Now, the classic example in our domestic sense, and here's my segue, Sally, is antimicrobial prescribing. So if you look at this, changing the prescribing behaviour of doctors is a complex interaction between the doctor and the patient. Now, on malaria, we've done quite a lot of anthropology on this, and there's a really beautiful paper by one of my colleagues called Claire Chandler called Guidelines and Mindlines, which I really recommend reading at your stage of training, that talks about the complex interaction between individual doctors and one another in their peer group and doctors in society and doctors and their patients. This is replicated everywhere in the world. And trying to work out what are the levers both for patient health-seeking behavior and interactions, but also the medical profession and the paramedical professions and what they do irrationally and how we change them, is a complex area that really needs proper science behind it, rather than this is a great idea, we'll just tell people what to do and they'll do it, because we know that doesn't work, and antimicrobial resistance is the classic example of that.
It is indeed.
Agree. Sally, we have 5 minutes. Could you tell us where you know we are at the moment with science and how that is going to help the antimicrobial resistance situation? Tall order.
So what we do know is it's a growing problem, that across the world the use of antibiotics is going up dramatically. Most antibiotics go into animals, a large proportion for growth promotion rather than using hygiene and everything. A lot of that is avoidable, hygiene, good practice, more vaccines. I mean, our salmon farming uses vaccines. It doesn't use, as the Americans do, antibiotics. So we can reduce antibiotic use, but to reduce them in clinical care will need massive behavior change, and that takes you directly into the social sciences. And it's difficult. We are trying some nudge techniques, and we've done a nudge study, which we hope will be published soon, which did reduce antibiotic prescribing by GPs. So we have to preserve what we've got, because it's getting worse. It gets worse with development, just to loop back to what we were discussing about, because, you know, this isn't just about excess, it's about access. And as you get development, antibiotics are getting more and more to people who need them, but then we've got increasing resistance. Unfortunately, the surveillance map of the world is very bad, because many low-income countries don't have laboratories and do studies and report it. But we are lucky enough to have £260 million from the Fleming Fund to help build low-income country infectious laboratories capacity, capability. We need to preserve what we've got. That means changing behaviours, improving access. We need to have innovation. We need better point-of-care diagnostics so you do preserve what you've got. But we also need new antibiotics, new antimicrobials, and that needs a totally different system of incentivizing people to do the basic research and then pull them through. Mm. And so the Prime Minister asked Jim O'Neill, now Lord Jim O'Neill, to do an independent review on that issue. So we've got a terrific amount of work globally going on AMR, a global action plan agreed by all the countries through the WHO, and everyone's writing their country action plans, we hope. We're going to be supporting quite a lot of them. It's supported by the UN Agency for Food and Agriculture. It's supported by the equivalent for animals. We are hoping to get a session at UN General Assembly next September on it. We're working hard on this. But it is based on science, the science of surveillance, the science of understanding passage. But what we don't really know is, though we know most is prescribed in animals, we don't know how much that contributes to the AMR issues and the death rate in humans. And so we need a lot more work about that. I mean, there is evidence of salmonella going between species and colistin going between species, resistance going between species. But how much does this overuse, which isn't really necessary, in animals contribute to the problem we're seeing in humans with a quite significant death rate across the world? So it's an area where we need lots more science. We had disinvested in microbiologists and basic science. We've not got the behavioural scientists we need. We need a massive education programme. This is going to be the work of decades.
Are WHO coordinating that, Sally, well, through they, your good office? Or?
They coordinate the Global Action Plan and their role, and they lead the tripartite working between them, FAO and OIE. And yes, we're giving them some funding from the Fleming Fund to make sure they have enough people. The Netherlands has seconded an expert, Mark Sprenger, to lead the technical side. So they are a key part of this, yes.
I was in Copenhagen a couple of weeks ago looking at the company that produces colistin and polymyxin, and that was a week before the reports came out from China. And the company in Copenhagen said, we are the world producers of the polymyxins. And then the paper comes out in China. They've been using tens of tons of unpurified fermentation product with polymyxin in for pig fattening. And this is where they think the resistance has come from. And that's produced in China. Nobody knows.
Probably,
where.
Yeah.
Chris? Can I just add a few comments to that? This is our kind of swan song point. The first of which is, don't forget that it's not just antibacterials.
Yeah.
There is a growing problem, there's a large problem with anti-TB resistance. There's, of course, a problem with HIV drug resistance, and that's really going to cause us significant problems, I think, in Africa in the next decade. And anti-malarial drug resistance is a very serious problem and is spreading from Southeast Asia and will spread. And the only question is how fast, not whether. So that's the first point. The second point is, I think that the danger we sometimes have is people assume that antimicrobial resistance is one problem. It's not actually. It's a whole series of actually essentially unrelated problems, for some of which getting new drugs is the key thing, for some of which is a basic science problem, some of which is a behavioral problem. And assuming that if you crack gram-positive antibiotic resistance in high dependency units, you're somehow cracking gram-negative typhoid resistance in other areas is to misunderstand the problem completely, and yet they're somehow talked as if they're the same thing. They're completely different things. And to go back to the question earlier on, some of them require basic science and some of them require applied science. And the final thing is, a lot of our solutions have unintended consequences. And just to go back to the malaria example that was given earlier, we've been actually very successful in many countries in swapping people from treating people who've got a test negative malaria with an anti-malarial, so they don't usually do that anymore. Now they give them an antibiotic,
yes,
which they previously didn't.
Yeah.
So we've actually substituted one potential resistance for another potential resistance. So we need to be careful that if we're just thinking down one track, we can actually improve one problem and make another problem worse.
I agree.
Good. Well, I knew time would run out and we could obviously go on for a long time, but we should finish now. It's getting rather hot in here as well. It's wonderful to know we have science leading through evidence, and the UK has a global leadership in this very clearly, and we have two leaders who are doing this for the UK and for the international situation we're in. So, Chris and Sally, all power to your arm, and thank you very much for coming this evening. Thank you.